ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे रामा हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा, वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट सैक्रिफाइस एंड it is said in the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, in the 33rd verse, Krishna explains the sacrifice of work ends in transcendental knowledge. Therefore, Krishna describes sacrifice of knowledge is greater than sacrifice of material possessions. To help us understand better what is the real purpose, what should be the real purpose of sacrifice, it should be transcendental knowledge. But many times people do perform sacrifices for other purposes, especially for some material gain. And yesterday I was narrating an incident from the Bhagavatam that there was one Tvashta, Brahmana by name Tvashta, whose son was killed by Indra, and Tvashta wanted to take revenge against Indra. So Tvashta performed a sacrifice in order to beget a son who would be powerful enough to kill Indra. But Tvashta made a mistake in the pronunciation of the mantra. And instead of a powerful person taking birth as son of Tvashta who would be competent to kill Indra, Indra became strengthened by Tvashta's sacrifice because of the wrong mantra he chanted. And nonetheless, the son was born from the sacrificial fire, and this son born of Tvashta from the sacrificial fire was a very 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 powerful demon by the name Vritra, because he was covering everything in the entire outer space. And this demon, he was a certain threat for the devatas. So Indra and all the other devatas, they went to attack this Vritrasura. He was an asura, he was a demon. And Vritrasura very easily swallowed whatever weapons Indra and the other devatas used to actually kill this asura. They were totally unable to do anything to this Vritrasura. Then the devatas decided that they have to take shelter of Lord Vishnu. So they began to worship Vishnu, and they offered very nice prayers. I described this yesterday, that Vishnu appeared and the devatas, their prayers were successful in making the Supreme Lord appear in front of them. So the devatas, they prayed to the Supreme Lord by first of all glorifying him in so many ways. And they particularly mention to the Supreme Lord Vishnu that you have always appeared in your various forms of incarnations to punish the demons as soon as they become very powerful. We therefore pray that your lordship appear today as another incarnation, if you so desire, to kill the demon Vritrasura. This was a specific request of the Devatas headed by Indra to the Supreme Lord. Also, the Devatas prayed to the Lord, O Lord, O Supreme Controller, O Lord Krishna, please annihilate this dangerous demon Vritrasura, Tvashta's son, who has already swallowed all our weapons, our paraphernalia for fighting, and our strength and influence. This was what is happening, actually, as far as the Devatas are concerned. This Vritrasura was simply swallowing up all their weapons and their paraphernalia. He was a very, very, very big threat for the Devatas. So when the Devatas offered their sincere prayers, the Lord listened very patiently, and being pleased, then the Lord began to speak. What did Lord Vishnu say? O best of the intelligent demigods, although it is true that nothing is difficult for one to obtain when I am pleased with him, a pure devotee whose mind is exclusively fixed on me does not ask me for anything except for engaging in devotional service. It's very clear. Lord Vishnu is telling, my pure devotees don't ask me any favor. If at all they have any request for me, their only prayer, only request is, please engage me in your service. Please grant me opportunity to serve you. This is the only prayer a devotee has, a pure devotee has. And then Lord Vishnu also tells, those who think material assets to be everything, or those who think that material possessions are the ultimate goal of life, they are called as misers, kripanas. They do not know the ultimate necessity of the real self or the soul. We have discussed this. We are not the body, we are spirit soul. This applies to every living being, all living beings, even on the higher planets. It applies to even the Devatas, everyone. Everyone, every living personality is actually the spirit soul, not the body. And in this material world, everyone has got a bodily covering. Everyone, all created beings have a material body which covers the spirit soul within. So, Lord Vishnu is telling, if somebody thinks that material possessions are the ultimate goal of life, they are really misers. They do not know what is the ultimate necessity of the spirit soul. So then, seeing that the Devatas were very much fixed upon getting the benefit from Vishnu about how to destroy this demon Vritrasura, so Lord Vishnu finally said, O Indra, all good fortune to you. I advise you to approach the exalted saint Dadichi. He has become very accomplished in knowledge, vows and austerities, and his body is very strong. Go ask him for his body without delay. So Lord Vishnu is instructing Indra, go to Dadichi Muni and ask him for his body. Why? Why is Vishnu telling, ask him for his body? Because Lord Vishnu further tells, when this Dadichi Muni awards you his body, Vishwakarma will prepare a thunderbolt from his bones. Thunderbolt is a weapon. Vajrayudha. So, this special weapon will be prepared from the bones of Dadichi Muni. This thunderbolt will certainly kill Vritrasura because it will be invested with my power. So, who is telling this? Lord Vishnu is telling that thunderbolt prepared from Dadichi's bones will have the power of Vishnu. Vishnu is supremely powerful. So it will never fail in the purpose for which it is employed. That assurance, that guarantee is being given by the Supreme Lord to Indra. Further, Lord Vishnu also assures Indra, when Vritrasura is killed by my spiritual strength, you will regain your strength, your weapons and your wealth. Whatever has been lost, because this Vritrasura is swallowing up everything. So don't worry, you will get it all back after Vritrasura is killed. There will be all good fortune upon you. Although Vritrasura can destroy the three worlds, do not fear that he will harm you. He is also a devotee and will never be envious of you. This is something very, very unusual. Lord Vishnu is telling this demon Vritrasura, he looks like a demon, but his heart is that of a devotee. So, Srila Prabhupada says, sometimes in the family of demons, a devotee may appear. Or somebody may appear in the body of a demon, but actually he is not a demon by nature. He is not of demoniac nature. He is actually a devotee at heart. So this assurance is given by Vishnu. Just like Prahlad appeared in the family of demons. Bali Maharaj appeared in the family of demons. So like that, very rarely of course, a devotee is born in the family of demons, or somebody appearing to have the body or the form of a demon actually is a devotee. So following the Lord's instructions, the devatas, they all went, headed by Indra, they went to Dadichi Muni. Actually, this Dadichi Muni was a very liberal saint. So, when they begged him for his body, he at once partially agreed. He didn't fully agree at once because he just wanted to hear religious principles from the mouth of the devatas. Therefore, he smiled and jokingly spoke to the devatas as follows. What did Dadichi Muni tell the devatas after hearing their request? Dadichi Muni said, in this material world, every living being is very much addicted to his material body. This is a fact. Whoever has taken birth, generally their conception is, I am this body. So when they think they are their body, they are very much attached to the body. Struggling to keep his body forever, everyone tries to protect it by all means, even at the sacrifice of all his possessions. To protect the body, people will do anything. Just like nowadays we see, somebody has got a very, Krishna forbid, somebody gets a very dangerous disease and they may be admitted to a super speciality hospital. Then the hospital may demand so much money to treat that disease, and somehow they will try to spend whatever money they have, and even sometimes take a loan to undergo the treatment. So, as is being mentioned by Dadichi Muni, it's a fact. People are ready to sacrifice all their possessions simply to protect their body. So, therefore, Dadichi Muni is telling, who would be prepared to deliver his body to anyone, even if it were demanded by Lord Vishnu? He could understand that these devatas have gone to Lord Vishnu, and on the direction of Lord Vishnu, they have come to him. He could understand, because he was a tapasvi. So he could understand the devatas, how they have been affected and how they have approached Lord Vishnu and how Vishnu has directed them. Everything he knew. So he just wanted to hear from the devatas what will be their reaction when he says like this. So the devatas replied to Dadichi Muni, O exalted Brahmana, pious persons like you, whose activities are praiseworthy, are very kind and affectionate to people in general. What can't such pious souls give for the benefit of others? They can give everything, including their bodies. So the devatas are glorifying Dadichi Muni, that you are a very exalted person, so you are ready to sacrifice everything for others' benefit. And therefore, what is this body, sacrifice of body? It's nothing. Then the great sage Dadichi said, just to hear from you about religious principles, I refuse to offer my body at your request. Now, although my body is extremely dear to me, I must give it up for your better purposes, since I know that this body of mine will leave me today or tomorrow. This is a very important instruction for all of us. So always remember, ultimately, this body is not going to stay with us forever. This is what Krishna explains in the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Antavantaime deha nityasyokta sharirinaha. So whatever is explained in the Bhagavad Gita, the same thing is illustrated in the words of great saintly persons or the Supreme Lord himself in the Bhagavatam. So Dadichi Muni, an enlightened sage, he is telling, this body is going to leave me today or tomorrow. So therefore, let it be used for some better purpose than simply trying to keep the body for a little longer time. Why? Why should I keep this body? This body, which is eatable by jackals and dogs after death, does not actually do any good to me, the spirit soul. What is the use of the body? Everyone discards the body after some person dies. Nobody keeps the body. So it is simply something to be discarded after death. It is usable only for a short time and may perish at any moment. This is also a very important fact. Nobody can ascertain exactly what is going to be the moment of death. Death can come any time. So therefore, the body and its possessions, its riches and relatives, must all be engaged for the benefit of others, or else they will be sources of tribulation and misery. This is another very important instruction by Dadichi Muni for all of us. That as long as we have this body and we have some possessions connected with the body. After all, material possessions can be something which is connected with the body. It has nothing to do with the spirit soul, with the real me. Why? Because when I leave this body, I can't take anything material with me. I cannot take anything with me. So it is simply my material possessions are there as long as I have this body. Moment I have to leave the body and go away, the material possessions are useless for me. So therefore, as long as I have this body and I have some possessions, let me engage it for the benefit of others. Paropakar. In Sanskrit it is called paropakar. Benefit of others. So Dadichi Muni, the son of Atharva, another great sage, thus resolved to give his body to the service of the devatas. He placed himself, the spirit soul, at the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and in this way gave up his gross material body made up of five elements. So he was a fully enlightened personality. He controlled his senses, his life force, his mind and intelligence became absorbed in trance, and thus he cut off all his material bonds. He could not perceive how this material body became separated from his self. So this is the perfection of practicing spiritual life. When a spiritualist quits the body, he does not feel because the pain, because he cuts off all attachment at the time of quitting the body or even before that. This is possible only by absorbing oneself in thought of the Supreme Lord. So therefore Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, practice this absorbing the mind in thinking of Krishna before death comes. Therefore we practice chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, and the way we should practice is while we chant, we should hear and fix our mind completely in chanting and hearing. This has to be practiced. If we practice like this, whenever death comes, it doesn't matter. Whenever death comes, if we have practiced absorbing our mind in chanting and hearing Hare Krishna mantra, which is not different from Krishna, then we simply are going to Krishna, Krishna's abode at the end of this life. Whenever death comes, it doesn't matter. Then what happened? Indra very firmly took up the thunderbolt manufactured by Vishwakarma using the bones of Dadichi. Charged with the exalted power of Dadichi Muni and enlightened by the power of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Indra, riding on his carrier Airavata, surrounded by all the devatas, while all the great sages were praising him, he was shining very beautifully and pleasing all the three worlds. He went off to kill Vritrasura. So Indra was very much prepared, fully ready to kill Vritrasura using that special weapon that was given by the Supreme Lord himself by directing Indra to go to Dadichi, ask for his bones, ask for his body, and then take the bones and ask his this Vishwakarma to prepare this special weapon. Then Indra attacked Vritrasura and he killed Vritrasura. In this way, you can see Tvashta's sacrifice was actually ultimately a failure. Sacrifice means the purpose of the sacrifice. It was not really fulfilled. Tvashta wanted to take revenge against Indra. But what happened? Because of one mistake in chanting the mantra. A small mistake. It was a very small mistake. So therefore, we should always understand what is the real purpose of sacrifice. So there is a mystery behind the real purpose of sacrifice. Because in the Vedas, there are so many different sacrifices which are mentioned for different purposes. But the real goal of sacrifice is not exactly some material benefit. It is actually getting transcendental knowledge. Now, this transcendental knowledge itself is not the ultimate goal either. That is what Srila Prabhupada explains. The purpose of all sacrifices, in the 33rd verse, where Krishna says that better than sacrifice of material possessions is sacrifice in pursuit of transcendental knowledge. Now, please try to understand, sacrifice of knowledge, jnana yajna, does not mean we are sacrificing knowledge. No, we are performing sacrifice to arrive at the status of transcendental knowledge, to get transcendental understanding, spiritual understanding, spiritual enlightenment. This is the real purpose of sacrifice. But transcendental knowledge is not the ultimate goal of sacrifice, is not an end in itself. After coming to the stage of becoming spiritually enlightened, one should then gain release from all material miseries. How is that possible? By becoming materially detached. As long as the body is there, there will be some miseries afflicting the body. But the transcendental knowledge helps us to develop detachment. And through detachment, we become free from all, gain release from all material miseries. And ultimately, to engage in loving devotional service to the Supreme Lord Krishna. So the real ultimate goal is devotional service to Krishna. But this devotional service to Krishna, for those who are unable to directly take up this devotional service, such people have to gradually elevate themselves, step by step. So first, they have to perform their prescribed duties as sacrifice. Or they may perform any sacrifice for which they feel they can get some material benefit. But as they go on performing these sacrifices and realize that those material benefits are not really giving me inner satisfaction, they are not really solution to my material miseries, then they begin to inquire into what is the real purpose of sacrifice, as recommended in the Vedas. So then they understand the real purpose of sacrifice is transcendental knowledge. And with that transcendental knowledge, when they become enlightened spiritually, then they are able to gain release from all material miseries. And then ultimately they take up devotional service to the Supreme Lord Krishna. And in this way they perfect their life. Now, Krishna further instructs that to learn this truth about the real purpose of sacrifice and to understand what is the ultimate goal of life, one should approach a bona fide spiritual master. And from such a spiritual master, what is to be learned? That also Krishna explains. 34th verse, he says, approach a bona fide spiritual master. And 35th verse, he says, what is that transcendental knowledge that one gets by performing sacrifices? He says, the truth to be learnt is that all living beings are part of Krishna. All living beings are part of Krishna. They are in Krishna and they belong to Krishna. Three things Krishna tells. Transcendental knowledge. What is the transcendental knowledge? All the living beings are part of Krishna. So we are spirit soul, that we have understood from the second chapter. And we are part of the Supreme Spirit Krishna, Supreme Lord Krishna, Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna. And we are always situated in Krishna, means we are dependent. We are never independent. We are dependent. And we are situated in Krishna means we are always sheltered by Krishna. We are ashrita tattva. We always require ashraya. Ashraya means shelter. We cannot be without shelter. So presently we are in the shelter of Krishna's material energy. But actually we are meant to be in the shelter or protection of Krishna's spiritual energy. Why? Because we are spirit soul, we are spiritual by nature. So when we are in this material energy, it is an incompatible situation for us. What is the reason? Everyone in some way or other in this material world is having some material difficulty or material misery. Why? Because we as spirit soul, being spiritual by nature, we are in this material atmosphere, material nature. So matter and spirit are not able to go together. They don't go together, matter and spirit. So we should cut off all attachments to this material world, to material possessions, to material relationships, to everything material. And we should actually transfer ourselves by Krishna's mercy, Krishna's grace, Krishna's help to our spiritual nature. So that is what Krishna is instructing about transcendental knowledge. Let me take up some questions now. It is mentioned that the devotees of the Lord are more kind than the Lord because they understand the purpose of the Lord. Krishna is instructing in the third chapter that those who are engaged in performing their prescribed duties without attachment, they are properly engaged in doing their duties. But there are others who may be doing some duties but with attachment to the results. So Krishna advises that don't disturb people who are very much attached to the results of their work while they are engaged in performing their duties. But Srila Prabhupada says that the devotees of the Lord, out of compassion for such ignorant people, they understand the ultimate purpose of the Lord is actually to enlighten everyone, including the ignorant people, about the real goal of life is not simply to do some duties, get some material benefit and somehow make adjustment and try to live comfortably and happily in this world. No. So devotees take compassion upon ignorant people and try to educate them in Krishna consciousness. So the devotees, they understand the Lord's purpose ultimately, even though the Lord says don't disturb them. In what sense does the Lord say don't disturb them? Is that don't stop them completely from doing activities with attachment to result. Because as long as somebody is attached to result, they keep on doing different activities, even though they are doing some prescribed duties, still they are bound up in this material world and they keep on taking repeated birth. They are not able to get out of the cycle of birth and death. They are not able to get out of material bondage. So, by Krishna telling, don't disturb them, he tells, don't make them to stop work. Because if a person is not engaged in some activity, at least not engaged in doing his duties, then he will have to somehow be otherwise engaged and he will do something very, very sinful, which is worse than somebody doing their prescribed duties with attachment to the subject. In that sense, Krishna says, better they engage in some work than become idle, try to become idle, or worse still, they cannot be idle for a long time, so they will engage in some sinful activity. So don't divert them like that. But the devotees, don't make people stop doing their duties. What the devotees do is, devotees instruct them to actually engage in devotional service in such a way that they are able to do whatever they are doing in Krishna consciousness. They are able to do the same activity in Krishna consciousness. Gradually, by doing it in Krishna consciousness, they are able to change their heart or their consciousness, and then they become properly situated to develop detachment from the results of the work by offering those results eventually to Krishna and thereby becoming liberated from material bondage. Next question. If somebody is in a place, some other place like France, what date and time should he follow while observing Ekadashi fast? Should he follow Indian standard time or local French time? Actually, the Vedic calendar says, since the sunrise time varies from place to place, like country to country like this, India and France, therefore you should follow French timings rather than Indian standard time. In India, we would follow Indian standard time, even in observing Ekadashi fast. In France, you should follow whatever the French time. Next question. Is divorce considered sinful if it is due to irreconcilable differences in marital life? Actually, in the Vedic scriptures, there is no mention of divorce at all. Srila Prabhupada explains this. So, whether it is considered sinful or not sinful, we cannot say, because nothing about divorce is mentioned. So then, the next part of the question is, what if after divorce one does not get remarried and devotes life to Krishna consciousness? Is that permissible? Very much. Yes, whatever be anybody's situation, nobody is barred from devotional service. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita 9th chapter, even the most sinful person, if some or the other is able to begin devotional service and takes complete shelter of Krishna, such a person is completely free from all sinful reactions through performing devotional service. So everyone is instructed by Krishna to actually take up devotional service. Specifically in this age, start chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Everyone is eligible, everyone is instructed, everyone is advised, please take up devotional service, especially chanting Hare Krishna, and you can perfect your life irrespective of what the background or the circumstances under which somebody began devotional service. That doesn't matter. Next question. Why is it said that the same question, similar question. Okay. Another question. Instead of offering some edibles in the sacrificial fire and burning it, isn't it better to offer food to people who really need it? As I explained, the sacrifice performed in terms of Sankirtan Yajna, there is no need to do any fire sacrifice. The sacrifice of chanting Hare Krishna does not involve any fire sacrifice. But even then, if somebody wants to give some food to needy people, instead of simply giving them some food, you better give them prasadam. You offer the food that you intend to give to others, first you offer to Krishna, and then give the needy person some prasadam. What is the benefit? The needy person not only will get food, but will also get some spiritual benefit. By eating prasadam, one gets nourishment for the body, for the mind, for the intelligence and for the soul. All are nourished very nicely. So ultimately there is spiritual benefit in distributing prasadam instead of simply distributing some food. I'll stop here. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.